As should be very clear for longtime viewers of this channel, the Cold War was a truly global affair. The tension and struggle between the United States and the Soviet Union served as a backdrop for events all over the world, even places not traditionally thought of as part of the Cold War. One of these places is West New Guinea. In the 1950s and 1960s, it found itself in the middle of an international dispute between its old colonial master, the Netherlands, and the newborn nation of Indonesia. I'm your host David, and today we are going to look at the West New Guinea dispute, an intersection of nationalism, imperialism, realpolitik, and the questionable application of the principles of international law. This is the Cold War. New Guinea, also known as Papua or Irian, is the second largest island in the world. Its western half was a part of the Dutch East Indies since 1828, nominally ruled by the Sultan of Tidore, whose dynasty's economic power rested on the trade of Papua's two chief export items, slaves and birds of paradise feathers. In practice, however, Papua was governed directly by the Dutch. And to be honest, governed is a strong word. According to Dutch reports, Irian's indigenous population of approximately 700,000 was considered to still live in the Stone Age, and half of the population had no contact with the administration whatsoever. What few Europeans and Asians there were in Papua were mostly confined to the coast, where Dutch rule had some influence. Keep in mind, West New Guinea's rich gold and copper deposits were still undiscovered, and its crude oil was difficult to access, especially when compared to the rest of the Dutch East Indies. Its soil contained too much limestone and coral, and pounding tropical rains continuously washed away organic matter, leaving little hope for successful crop cultivation. As a result, the colony was largely unprofitable, neglected, and described as, quote, one of the least developed areas of the world. Which might beg the question as to why the Dutch kept it. Well, the answer to that is that the Dutch used it as a buffer zone between the more valuable Moluccas in the west and the potential colonies of other European powers further east. One of West New Guinea's few places of note was the dreaded Boven de Hoel, a detention area sometimes referred to as a concentration camp that was used for political prisoners. It was surrounded by jungle, malarial swamps, and hostile natives, making escape all but impossible. Boven de Hoel is where many of Indonesia's communist rebels of 1926 found themselves following the failure of their revolution. Sending dissidents to New Guinea was a Dutch version of sending them to Siberia. Okay, so Papua seems like a pretty rough place at this time. This raises a question: why bother having a dispute over it? Economically, West New Guinea was a hindrance rather than an asset. To quote one of the contemporary Dutch researchers on the matter, quote, the loss of New Guinea, from the economic viewpoint, can only signify a gain for the Netherlands. However, a dispute over who controlled the territory dragged on for years, and evidently both the Netherlands and Indonesia saw some symbolic value in Papua. Let's start with the Dutch position. The Netherlands was a fading colonial power, still processing the loss of its colonial crown jewel. Sorry, Suriname and Curaçao. The loss of national prestige resulting from Indonesia's independence had been an unpleasant experience for right-wing Dutch politicians, who argued that the Dutch flag needed to wave at least somewhere in Oceania. Otherwise, the Netherlands would, to their horror, descend to the, quote, rank Denmark. But keep in mind that the Dutch position didn't rest solely on nationalist pride. There was, especially among the Calvinist political parties, a positive sentiment towards Eurasians, people of mixed ancestry who now feared for their future as part of a newly independent Indonesia. West New Guinea was to become their new homeland, a Christian tropical Holland, if you please. As the unfeasibility of such a project became more and more obvious, Dutch paternalistic reasoning shifted its attention from Eurasians to native Papuans, who were, as the Dutch claimed, racially different from Indonesians and allegedly required a long period of European guidance and tutelage for their own good before they would be ready to exercise self-determination. This is the all-too-familiar white man's burden narrative that the Dutch had used to legitimize their rule over Indonesia and was used by most European colonial powers to justify remaining where they were no longer wanted. Now, speaking of Indonesia, its position on the matter of Papua was rather straightforward. On August 17, 1945, Sukarno and Hatta had proclaimed the independence of the entirety of Indonesia, and the War of Independence had been waged by the New Republic on behalf of the people of Irian, just as those of Sumatra or Java. Removing the Dutch administration from New Guinea was a matter of ending colonial rule and completing the quest for full independence. Now, we've already done an episode on the Indonesian War of Independence, but a quick overview of the actual sequence of events is always useful. In 1946, early into the war, the Dutch organized a series of conferences to formulate proposals for the reorganization of its colonial empire into something akin to the British Commonwealth. It was attended mostly by delegates from the East, where the Dutch were still reasonably in control. But their desire to properly represent Papua at this conference was rather lacking, given that they only allowed a single Papuan delegate, and then only at the first of the three conferences, and the delegate was not even from New Guinea itself, but from the neighboring Biak Islands. The results of these conferences came from the final conference held in Denpasar on the island of Bali. The Lieutenant Governor General of the Dutch East Indies, Hubertus van Mook, through his personal influence against the inclusion of Western New Guinea in the new state of the Great East. The Great East was a federal unit within the future Indonesian state, composed of the islands east of Java and Borneo. The delegates at Denpasar, who in reality lacked any political power and had been selected by the Dutch in the first place, had to agree. But maybe it wasn't that bad of a deal after all. West New Guinea could still join the United States of Indonesia without being a part of the Great East, right? Okay, so how did the Dutch sell this to Sukarno and Hatta? Well, the truth is they didn't. The first major treaty signed between the Netherlands and the Republic of Indonesia, the Linggadjati Agreement, was signed prior to the Denpasar Conference. The treaty said nothing about New Guinea and even explicitly mentioned that the United States of Indonesia would be composed of the entire former Dutch East Indies. It also mentioned that people unwilling to join Indonesia could change their political status in this new post-colonial political structure, quote, by means of a democratic process. How a largely Stone Age Papua was to engage in this democratic process was not specified. As the war went on, there was no indication that a final agreement or resolution regarding West New Guinea was to be reached. If anything, things actually got worse. To fulfill the Linggadjati Agreement, the Dutch constitution needed to be amended, which required a two-thirds majority in both houses of parliament. The government coalition between the Catholic People's Party and Labour Party didn't have enough seats to push the amendment through on its own, while the unholy alliance of the far-right anti-revolutionary party and the far-left communist party strongly opposed the agreement. This meant that to make the amendment possible, the government needed support from the center-right VVD and the Calvinist CHU. Those same parties, we should point out, wanted West New Guinea to stay Dutch. In 1949, representatives of the Netherlands and Indonesia met in The Hague for the Roundtable Conference to bring a final settlement to the question of Indonesia's independence. The subject of New Guinea was deliberately put last on the agenda in a hope that the two sides would, by that time, have already reached an agreement on all of the more important questions and would therefore be reluctant to derail the negotiations over the subject of Papua. Things were not made easier, though, by the fact that the Dutch had formally ended the nominal rule of the Sultan of Tidore over West New Guinea less than 2 months before the conference had begun. Without any compromise in sight, the delegates from the Netherlands and Indonesia decided to kick the can down the road. They would meet again in 1950, 1 year after the transfer of sovereignty to Indonesia, with the specific intent to discuss Papua. And until that happened, the status quo would be maintained. But by the time that that point was supposed to be a reality, the West New Guinea dispute would not be resolved. Following the Roundtable Conference, the Dutch used all of their characteristic thoroughness to set up a West New Guinean colonial administration and even created a legal framework establishing a local representative assembly, the West New Guinea Council. To make a long story short, this was anything but a temporary one-year solution. Indonesia, meanwhile, had experienced a series of insurrections, most notably in the South Moluccas. The alleged involvement of the Dutch in the matter, although denied, did little to improve the relations between the two sides. Although the delegates did meet in 1950, the negotiations predictably ended up in deadlock. Predictably, both sides did what most sides do when confronted with a deadlock. They looked for allies. The Dutch found one in Australia, which maintained control of the eastern half of New Guinea, and viewed the island as strategically important for its own defense. Indonesia, on the other hand, appealed to the emerging nations of Asia and Africa, most notably India. Unofficially, there were some talks of a compromise solution, with West Papua remaining under Dutch administration for 20 to 25 years, under the supervision of the United States, Indonesia, the Netherlands, Australia, and India, after which a plebiscite would be held. It was understood that it would probably result in the annexation of Papua by Indonesia, but that would have been a future concern. But the proposal was stillborn, as it was rejected by the Dutch government, which had by 1953 made a political turn to the right and was less willing to make concessions. Indonesia then appealed to the United Nations, an organization which was still hoped at the time to have the ability to resolve international disputes. A total of 4 attempts in the General Assembly were made to adopt a resolution favorable to Indonesia. They all failed. Indonesia was growing increasingly frustrated. To quote Foreign Minister Subandrio, quote, "The only question is whether the United Nations is the place where the solution may be worked out, or whether we must embark upon another course, even at the risk of aggravating conditions in Southeast Asia and perhaps inviting Cold War tensions to muddy further the waters of peace in that region of the world." Okay, so let's turn back to Papua itself. The Netherlands legitimized its rule over the western part of the island, aiming to advance the native population and prepare them for their eventual independence. Since the Dutch were in control of the territory, they were expected to put those policies into practice rather than just in rhetoric. And they did make some progress. By 1957, they had created numerous positions for Papuans in the government services and were seemingly on the road to having over half of government posts occupied by native Papuans. In February 1961, the West New Guinea Council was elected. With a representative body now in place, the Dutch proposed the Lunds Plan to the UN General Assembly, calling for a termination of Dutch sovereignty, followed by UN administration and the establishment of an international study commission that would supervise that administration and organize a plebiscite to determine the status of the territory. On December 1, 1961, the council agreed to call the new nation West Papua, adopting a national anthem and the Morning Star flag, and raising it later that day. The anniversary of this event is now celebrated as West Papua's Independence Day. For Indonesia, however, this looked like another Katanga. Sukarno, after multiple failed attempts at a diplomatic resolution, picked a corner. He repeatedly gave hints to the United States that Indonesia, with Soviet assistance, would take Irian by force. The newly elected Kennedy administration took those threats seriously and considered that, in the words of security advisor Robert Cummers, a few thousand square miles of cannibal land wasn't worth pushing Indonesia into the open arms of the Soviet bloc. Sukarno wasn't bluffing either. Jakarta had already started a massive Soviet-backed increase in its military expenditure. Operation Trikora was announced on December 19, 1961, with the goal of taking control of West Papua. On January 15, 1962, 3 Indonesian Navy torpedo boats engaged Dutch aircraft and several destroyers of the Dutch Navy. One Indonesian torpedo boat was sank, while the other 2 managed to disengage. As of 2023, the Battle of Arafura Sea remains the last naval victory in Dutch history. But despite the victory, this marked a turning point. The United States, unwilling to deal with another war in the region and its potentially communism-friendly consequences, decided to back Indonesia. After Robert Kennedy visited Jakarta and The Hague in February to urge talks, both sides agreed to negotiate. Meeting in Virginia, the Netherlands and Indonesia agreed to the Bunker Plan. West New Guinea would be handed over to the UN for a short period of time, and then to Indonesia, with the final step being an act of self-determination organized jointly by Indonesia and the UN. Transfer of territory to Indonesia would happen before the plebiscite. The terms, previously rejected by the Netherlands as a mockery of the principles of free choice, were endorsed in a UN resolution in a vote of 89 votes in favor, 0 opposed, with 14 abstentions, despite objections from Dahomey, Upper Volta, and Togo. The West Papua dispute was over. But for the people of West Papua, things were just starting. Indonesian commandos arrived on the island before UN forces and stayed there, ostensibly to assist the local police. In practice, they were there to assert Indonesian control by means of mass arrests and torture. Jakarta made plans to settle 400,000 Javans on the island. Concessions were given by Indonesia's government to a US company, Freeport Indonesia, to exploit West Papua's natural resources, allowing it to take the property of the native population and resettle them, often to inhospitable malarial areas, while providing, quote, reasonable compensation only for immovables. After the UN force departed, an armed struggle began between Indonesia and the newly created Free Papua Movement. In response to various Papuan insurgencies, the Indonesian military conducted machine gun strafing runs from aircraft, killing dozens and forcing thousands into the wilderness. And needless to say, there was no plebiscite. 1,024 West Papuans were picked to represent about 750 people each and vote in a so-called act of free choice. Any of those 1,024 representatives who advocated voting for independence were publicly threatened with on-the-spot execution. These delegates were kept under close guard before they, shockingly, ended up voting unanimously for joining Indonesia. A UN team observing the process affirmed the legitimacy of the result, concluding, quote, "An act of free choice has taken place in accordance with Indonesian practice." Indonesia's control over West Papua was internationally acknowledged and undisputed, only challenged by the native Free Papua Movement and its guerrilla activity. Indonesian operations became increasingly brutal. Its military engaged in extrajudicial killings, torture, massacres, public execution of pregnant women, and rape. Indonesian aircraft were particularly deadly, attacking from the air using machine guns and cluster bombs. A bombing in the Paniai Lakes district, for example, resulted in a death toll estimated between 2,500 and 13,000 people, with locals even claiming the use of napalm and chemical weapons. What has become the Papua conflict, with its fluctuating intensity and brutality, continues to this day. We hope you've enjoyed this episode, and to make sure you don't miss our future work, please make sure you subscribe to our channel and have divided the bell button in two, with one half remaining under the control of the last video you watched, while the other half tries to gain control by any means necessary. Please consider supporting us on Patreon at patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com. This is the Cold War Channel, and as we think about the Cold War, please remember that history is shades of gray and rarely black and white.